don't forget to laugh at the ego, which is really our own whimsicality, because the ego is completely nuts. When you expose how completely crazy the ego is, you run the risk of people thinking that you must be nuts, because they know that there's something you're talking about is nuts. But the continuity problem makes them think, well, it can't be the ego, so it must be you, so it must be the messenger. It is not easy to do these videos and talk about it. It's very stressful, because of course, the continuity problem is going to get people to say, now wait a minute, maybe he's crazy, or maybe, what is he talking about? The ego, the ego's plan is to annihilate us and that'll solve all our problems. That's what the ego believes, that the ego believes it can solve all our problems. Why? It can drive us into spiritual suicide is what the ego believes. And it certainly tries and can drive us into something that is incredibly terrible suffering beyond anything that you can imagine. You're just like, unbelievable how bad the suffering can get, the mental suffering. But we can't die, so it can't drive us into actual suicide. It's impossible. So the ego's great deal it has for us is, guess what? All your problems are solved. You're annihilated forever. No more problems. That's its great wisdom. The ego's great wisdom. Yeah, you gotta hand it to the ego. That's quite a plan. Quite a plan. Genius. Pure genius, you know, what problems? You don't exist anymore, you don't have any problems. Eternal death, you have no more problems. Yeah, but that's kind of, what is it? It's sort of lacking, right, in suitability. It doesn't really suit us, does it? So we look for another suitor, don't we? Yes, and there's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit shows up and says, hey, here's another suitor for you. You know, hey, how about me? what are you? And the Holy Spirit says, well, I'll show you bit by bit. And okay, fair enough. Okay, let's find out. Let's let the Holy Spirit be a suitor for our attention and see how it goes. Well, gradually, we get to unravel this mystery of the ego's confidence. You know, why is the ego so confident? We get to unravel that. And so gradually we begin to orient towards the vision of oneness. Gradually. It doesn't happen all at once. So don't expect it just to be easy, happen all at once. The continuity problem precludes that, really. It really makes it like a step at a time, or two steps forward, one step back kind of thing. It doesn't really happen very easily at all. It can be steady, but not necessarily really fast. Okay, so that is the issue. Day by day. So we want to get into the vision of oneness. Okay, how do we do that? That is the question that should preoccupy our minds. Now, the advice we have is that we have to simply remove the blocks to the awareness of its presence, and it's already there. We need to move the blocks. We don't need to establish it. So our effort should not be to, how do I establish the vision of oneness? No, it's already there. Merely remove the blocks. Be willing to make a tiny shift in emphasis, really. Just a tiny shift in emphasis is all it takes. Tiny shift in valuing is all that it takes. Now, if we realize that the ego's gift offered to us, the deal, is that eternal death will solve all our problems. It'll even solve our ego problem, the ego says. It is an all-in-one solution from the ego. But doesn't that really leave everything unsolved? Really? It doesn't really resolve anything, does it? So we have to look at what the ego's offering us and then what the Holy Spirit's offering us and compare the two. Just compare it. One's offering us eternal death, the other eternal life. Which do we want more? Can't have both, can we? We can't be eternally dead and at the same time experience eternal life. I know the ego tells us we can. It says, don't worry, you can do it, it's easy. Don't worry, you can do it. The ego says, you can do it, you can do it. Yeah, I know you can do it. And I say, how do you know that, ego? Because the ego says, because I'm God, and anything I want to have happen will happen. So definitely you can do it, because I want it to happen. Well, no, it wants eternal death to happen, after which it doesn't have to answer to the second part. A rebirth doesn't have to, because you're not there to complain about not happening. So the ego is really quite a funny, you know, it's a clown. It's offering us this ridiculous stuff with a straight face. You know, it's just like, why did you want this? I'm telling you, it's going to work for you. And the more we see it, the funnier it gets, which is very important. Jesus said, really, though, he said that the only thing we did wrong is we forgot to laugh at this nonsense. We forgot to laugh. If we would have laughed at it, it would have been poof, gone. We forgot to laugh. So we really have to keep the sense of humor and chuckle about it, actually. We're serious, we're sober, we're repentant, we confess that we have a severe continuity problem. We're in the mood of repentance. But I know, or did I say that we don't chuckle about what we're looking at? Now, that's part of the mood of repentance, is we do get a good laugh. Not a out of hysterical laugh or weird, just a good chuckle. You know, it's funny. It's funny. The ego is coming up to us and thinking, I have a great deal for you. I got the best deal possible. I have the best stuff possible. Here's this. The ego says, this is way better than the Holy Spirit. Are you kidding me? You can do this right now. All you have to do is die eternally, and then don't worry, I'll raise you from the dead after you're eternally dead. Don't worry, you can trust me, the ego says. And we just have to keep laughing at that. if we take it seriously, then we're in trouble, really in trouble. The ego says, don't worry, you can trust me. You can trust me. You know, don't worry, you can trust. Well, I think that's a big worry. First of all, we can't kill ourselves, so we're worried about that right there, that you told us we can when we can't. So there's reason to not trust the ego right there. But that it just keeps peddling it this stuff. Hey, don't worry. You know, if you just find a way to kill the spirit, kill your spirit, then everything will be perfectly fine for you. You don't have to worry at that point. I guess if you're eternally dead, you wouldn't have any worries, would you? So the ego leaves out the part that if that would happen, the ego would also be eternally dead. See, it doesn't quite understand that, because it thinks it's separate. It's a separate will. And that our eternal death will establish, it will remove its only opposition that it has. It doesn't know it's a projection. So we say, ego, we better not do that, because that wouldn't be good for you. You know. Remain good-humored about it, really, if at all possible. Jesus said the final step is you have a good laugh, and then that's it. That is it. That's probably very true. So this is all part of aiming your valuing to the vision of oneness. It's all part of it. Is you're shrinking down the ego, this deal. You're starting to laugh at its deal. Laughable, you know. So it's so laughable, you know, it makes the vision of oneness seem much, much more acceptable to us. It used to be, we thought the vision of oneness is something obscure, mystical, romantic, fantasy, mythic thing, you know. It's only like some avatar in ancient times may have experienced and all this kind of stuff. That's what the ego hopes. It hopes it can make us all mythical to the ego. Yeah, the ego believes in human goodness, human kindness. Oh, this vision of oneness, oh, that's a myth, the ego says. That's something that you need to... it's kind of like a sort of an archetypal myth that's come out of the past of human evolution that has something to do with our feeling of rootlessness and nomadic life, and maybe something to do with our diet was deficient in something, you know. Or it could have been a genetic mutation from some sort of problem that we had, and we need to, well, don't worry, we'll be able to do the gene splicing and stuff and get that out of your system. Ah, the ego is full of great helpfulness. Yeah. And so most people are buying into this. I see that. I look at comments of people, and it's like on different websites, etc., and they're like, oh yeah, just good old-fashioned human kindness. That's the highest value there is, no question. This other stuff, this religious, spiritual stuff, it's like some sort of mythical, sort of vague mythical relic or something, and it doesn't connect, you know. It's got no value at all. But human goodness, you know. Yeah, we got the bad guys, we locked them up, put them away, and good guys won again. That's it. Yeah, we're really now advancing. The ego says we're advancing in our society. We're advancing, making great advances. Finally, we're letting go of this fixation with, you know, the name of God, the vision of Christ, the equal vision, cosmic consciousness, pure awareness, abiding as the self, all this stuff. Wow, what is that? This stuff is just gibberish, you know. We've almost got it made. We almost have a Starbucks on every corner now. As long as we reach that, the gospel will have been spread throughout the planet, right? the good gospel of good coffee, strong coffee gospel. Yea, when it shall be spread throughout the land, the gospel of coffee shall set ye free of all archaic, mythic thought patterns buried deep in your genes that need to be expunged and purged from your thought patterns in the future. But we're almost there. We're almost there with the coffee shop on every corner, maybe even two in the block. So we're almost at the golden age, you know, almost there. Just got to do a few things before we get there, you know. The ego's getting ready for that, to do a few things, you know, to get there. Just a kind of a few minor things, you know. Just sort of a cleanup operation, you know. There's some ants on the counter and I need to kind of clean them up. Just cleaning things up. And people will nod approvingly and then say, yeah, that's good, great. Now, needed to clean, you know, do some house cleaning, basically. It's just basically a house cleaning that's coming up, is what the ego tells us, just a house cleaning. You know, spring cleaning is coming up. Wise ones know what the ego's up to. You see, they're not fooled by its cover. It loves to hide behind the face of innocence. The ego does. Loves to hide behind that. Now, loves to hide behind children, little girls especially. Says, oh, look, the little girls. You don't want to alarm them. Their expectations, they have to be met in the world. They expect the world to be this secular paradise with nobody here in this world except the slackers. And you see somebody doing prayer and focused on spiritual exercise, they'll be alarmed. They'll be nervous. They won't know what to do. They'll go running, daddy, I'm so scared. I'm crying. What happened? What happened? I saw someone was crazy. I saw a crazy person there. They were praying to God. And I'm hysterical. You taught me to be freaked out when that happens, right? Oh yeah, I did. I taught you that. Oh yeah, I'm so freaked out. Oh my God. Then you go and talk to the one who's praying. Listen, you did a terrible thing. We're going to have to take severe measures against you. You upset my little daughter. You upset my little daughter. She's so upset. You freaked her out, as a matter of fact. Exactly. The ego loves that. Sets up expectations, tells the little innocent children, look, innocent children, this is what you're going to encounter in the world, okay? This is what the ego tells them. This is how we're being trained now. This is what you're supposed to encounter in the world. I'm telling you, the world is safe for you. Safe to be a slacker. It's safe to be a slacker. Don't worry. Don't worry. Everything's fine. There are no slackers. There are no unslackers here, okay? There aren't any. But just in case you ever encounter one, by the rare case you may encounter one, you know, it's a very scary thing, very unsettling. It's going to really freak you out badly, okay? Do you get that? You need to really freak out badly and scream and raise an alarm, and okay? You got that? And so they train the little kids. That way. And so little kids go out in the world and they say, okay, I know exactly what to expect. And I'm sure I'm never going to encounter what I don't expect. There's a world full of wonderful slackers here. And then they come across. And then the parents say, why don't you go into this church or go into this synagogue or go into this mosque or go into this ashram or go into this meditation hall or go into this place of worship? Why don't you just go in there and just see what's in there? So a little girl, boy goes in there. Huh? What's this? You know. Oh my God, you know, these people, crazy people here. And sobbing and hysterics, and parents say, what happened? I'm so scared, I'm so frightened. My self-esteem is plummeting. You know, I feel like I'm worthless. Oh, this is terrible, terrible. Parents go to the authorities and say, you know, look what they did to my little girl. Look what they did. Severe emotional damage. Authorities say, wow, we can't have that. That's terrible. It's bullying or something. You know, it's imposing abnormality on the children. We can't have that. Better shut this place down. That's exactly what's happening in the world, as a matter of fact. That is the ego's strategy, as it might be, is to train these little children, indoctrinate them to such an extent that they are taught to freak out purposely to try and then bring the authorities, you know, the heavy-handed authorities say, well, you know, you're freaking out little innocent children. You can't do that. That's like teaching a little child to walk in front of a car and then yank the driver's license and their car, take their car away. He says, "You look what you did. You almost hit this child or something." Even though the parent like pushed the child in front of the car, you know, it's like that. That's the low down, scurrilous strategy of the ego. Go out and push your children in front of cars, and then blame the driver. So what they're doing is they're pushing their children in front of those who are not slackers. Unslackers who are really after the vision of oneness, aligning their values with that, push them in front of that and then tell them to freak out and say, oh my God, I almost died. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. It caused me to go insane. I'm going to go insane. I can't stand this. I'm having flashbacks. I can't go to school. What? That's another thing. How come your daughter's not in school, parent? Oh, they ran across this church or something. And she was so damaged psychologically by it, she's afraid to go to school. She has agoraphobia now. She can't attend class. Then the authorities say, holy cow, that's money for us here. You're talking about money. And we get money every day she goes to school. Says, we can't have that. Well, how'd this happen again? Oh, okay. We'll take care of it. We'll take care of that. Don't worry. We can't have that spreading around. You know, we need the children to attend school. So yeah, they're taught to be damaged by this and have all these symptoms, you know, all these terrible symptoms. feel like I'm just withdrawn. I want to sit in my room. What, something's terribly wrong with me? I'm all nervous, you know? Well, they're probably nervous about their parents is what they're really nervous about. Any parents who would indoctrinate their children that way, you should be nervous about them. We got a whole planet full of those kind of people right now. A whole planet full of them. And, of course, we're thinking, everything's fine. No, it's not. It's not fine. Because when the ego starts playing this child card, which it has all set up, it's all set up for that. You got the parents, you got the grandparents, you got the children all on the same page. It needed, you know, three solid generations. It needed three solid generations to make this work. So, you had, like, the generation that came of age in 1970, let's say, who are of age, the baby boomers, they were heavily indoctrinated, okay. Now, they have a child, and say, let's say they have a child in 1970. You can even move it further, but let's just do the math. 1970, the child grows up by the time 1990, they're 20. Let's say, even the year 2000, they're 30. So you could actually push it back. And if they had a child when they're, say, they were 20, in 1990, the child would be 24 already. So this, you could even have four generations. You could even have four generations. You could have someone, a child in 1970. Okay, first generation has a child in 1970. Next one in 1990. The next one in 2010. And then the next one, then the children from that would be 4 years old. So you could actually have four generations easily. Even if you back it up more to 1965, whatever, you can have easily solid three generations and even four generations now of people who have been indoctrinated in the ego's plan. If you start in 1970, or you get a child born in 1970 and then go from there, 1990, 2010, four-year-olds. So four-year-olds, five-year-olds, that's about the, you know, six-year-olds, seven-year-olds, young children with three or four generations now. There'd be the four, so three backing them up. Fourth generation, their fourth generation indoctrination from the ego's blueprint plan here of how to exterminate, you know, the Holy Spirit from this planet. And so you have this mindset that's backed up by the whole family unit now. All right, and anybody, the generation even before that is so old now, they got no juice, they got no say. And they're saying, you know, we can't raise our children in this kind of environment with these kooks around. You know, these kooks, they're unnerving the kids. Because they had three or four generations of training the kids how to be, pull this criminal, you know, con job on the world. You have really three or four generations of con artists in this world, actually, is what you really have. And they're teaching their children, they're using their children to attain their aims. These children, you know, have been, you know, indoctrinated into freaking out when they come across any ideas, any mindset that is different than what they should expect. And so the mantra in the world is, you should only come across what you expect, and anything you don't expect must be suspect, must be bad, must be expunged, because it's harming your potential. It's harming your potential for what? Potential to succeed at the ego's plan, which is what? It's annihilating yourself, of course. So when you come across those that say you cannot annihilate yourself, you are spirit, you're not body. The little people, the children freak out and say, someone said I wasn't a body. They're attacking my identity. They're causing me to have a psychological meltdown. I'm unable to find my identity. I'm having a crisis, you know. And then authorities come in and say, you can't teach that. You can't teach that anymore. That's upsetting the children. How can we have we need the children to be strong and intelligent here and reach their potential. That's the plan of the ego that's going on. And people, if they look at it, they realize, oh yeah, that is the plan. Uh-oh, we're in trouble, the world's in trouble. Of course it's in trouble. You've had four generations. And there could even been someone born in 1950, right, who had a child in 1970, who had a child in 1990, who had a child in 2010, and that child is now 4 or 5 years old. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You know, 5, 50, 70, 90, 10, that's five generations. And 1950, you know, is someone born in 1950 would be a baby boomer, wouldn't it? Yeah. One, and a two, and a three, maybe that's four. How can I, let me see. Born in 50, and then that one has child 1970, that one has another child in 90, and that one has another child in 2010. Boomer, 70, 90, 10, maybe four generations, that's four, because the child would be the fourth generation. But that's all it takes. They say three generations is all it takes, is you get three generations of indoctrination, you can turn things around in the world. That's why the ego's taken this time since 1970. It's been 44 years, and it's got now, it's got the indoctrination that it needs on this planet, which is why I say the war is broken out now, because the indoctrination is sufficient, and the support system for it stretches back far enough. It can stretch all the way back to the 1950s, and even the great great great, you know, grandparents of back before that have gotten along for the ride too. So you really have a planet where you have long generational indoctrination already. It's already happened. Someone born in 1930, first generation, born in 1950, that's the second generation. Born in 1970, that's the third generation. Born in 1990, that's the fourth generation. Born in 2010, that's the fifth generation. See, that's the fifth generation. Born in 2010 would be the fifth generation from 1930, fifth generation already. And this, you know, and people born in 1930 right now, a lot of them are very much hooked into being total slackers and thinking that's the answer. Very hooked into the whole modern ideology, thinking that this is super advanced, this is the way. So where can the resistance come from if you're talking about five generations, let alone four, let alone three? Where can the child go for any sort of other viewpoint is the question. Certainly not on television, radio, magazines, books, popular media, of movies of any kind. Is there any hint, not even a hint, of the vision of oneness, the true vision of oneness? Is there any hint? See, where can they go for their relatives for a hint of that? If they happen to, you know, be in that stream of indoctrination, even great 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 granny, you know, can't set them straight, and their great grandparents and their grandparents and their parents and all the way back, nobody. There's nobody, nowhere to go. So it's like a complete brainwashing effort, actually. And so when you reach that point, the ego knows it's got the advantage now. And it can press its advantage. Once it gets the advantage, it will press its advantage. And it will claim that you have no right, if you upset the children through, you know, they're coming across teachings, that the teachings have to go. You know, it's not, in other words, the children are right way because the parents agree, the grandparents agree, the great-grandparents agree, and the great-great-grandparents agree. They all agree that the child's reaction is normal. They all say, this is perfectly normal. And society agrees, needs the revenue. Everything is aligned, you see, to say that's a normal reaction. And so they're not to blame. It's the one who's the non-slackers of the world, who are actually focusing on the vision of oneness. Those are the ones who are creating the problem with our children. See, our children are our future, as the ego sects to say. The children are our future. So you can't mess with our future. You're messing with our future, is what they'll say. So you need to go now, is what they will say. And of course, people have not been looking in this direction so much. Right? It's very sneaky. The ego is a snake. The ego creeps up on you, and you don't even hear it coming. It loves to work with generations and demographics. It takes a long view and it says, okay, we need to capture three full generations. We need to a certain demographic situation, right, of a lot of young people in the world who are, one, a bit confused. When you reach a certain point where you tip over into the personality, you feel like you're lacking an identity, or you're feeling like you have an identity crisis. And so anything can set them up easily, very volatile, very full of energy, very full of revolution, all this kind of, you know, stuff. And lacking in perspective, especially if you can't go to your parents or grandparents or great-grandparents or great-great-grandparents and ask them for some perspective, like, how did it used to be, you know? Could you tell me, like, what the world used to be like? I remember I would do that. I'd listen to my grandparents and my uncle's parent and my parents and older people. I'd say, what was it like 100 years ago, you know, or 200, or can you tell me about your great-grandparents? Can you tell me what life was like? What did they believe back then? You know, what were their belief systems? How about punishment? What was wrong? What was considered bad and wrong then? You know, what were your values back then? I wanted to know, what's the difference now? What's going on here? Where is this, you know, where are we going? Where have we been? But if it stretches back now, people, so far, that there's nowhere to go. And they say, and I know the young people say, well, all information that's important is on the internet. Anything that's not on the internet is not important. The internet's one of the most myopic, biased sources of information possible, actually. It's unbelievably shallow, the internet. I know young people think that's all they know is the internet, right? They think everything worth knowing is on the internet. Let me tell you. The internet, for the most part, is just junk. It's just junk food. Just junk food. Now, I've tried to do something about that, you know, because I feel sorry for the people. It's just like, how can you even, it's just so ludicrous. The internet is so superficial, so utterly biased. It's the attitudes of young, indoctrinated people for the most part. And it's probably the worst source of information there is, and yet most people think it's the best. So obviously that's a huge problem. And of course they expect on the internet to only come across what they expect to come across. So if they come across something different, they'll say, "Wow, what is this? That's not supposed to be here. My parents didn't tell me about that. Why is that there?" Get freaked out by it. So, you know, the ego is the snake, for sure. And it always is moving in this very serpentine, silent manner, marching through the ages like this, gradually, you know, subtly indoctrinating generation after generation after generation. And now you got a generation that whose values are like upside down, really, upside down. Basically, they value slacking. Let's just all smoke pot and hang out. Yeah, it's really cool. Maybe watch some movies. Let's smoke pot and watch some movies. That's it. That's just good enough. Now, of course, that's at one level. And the other level is, say, let's make $1 million. So when I talk about slacking, I mean spiritual slacking. I don't mean that young people are not working hard to make a ton of money. They are, because they want all the material things that money will buy. And but spiritually, they're, you know, very much slacking. Most of them are total slackers. Not all by any means. But, you know, the demographics are there for sure. And you're not going to get it done by smoking pot. That is for sure. Believe me, that is for sure. That turns you into a slacker, actually. It gives you a false sense of some sort of buzz, you know, that your perception has changed. See, here's changed perception. All I have to do is smoke a joint, and I got changed perception, just like that. That's as easy as it gets. And then when it doesn't, it's not quite good enough, and you know, cotton mouth, and red eye, and mind's going doom, 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 and you're tired, and need to eat a lot, I need to sleep, I kind of, they said, well, that, and then you say, hey, you know, it didn't, I kind of wasn't like perfect, you know, and then the local dealer or your friends will say, oh man, you know, that wasn't the best stuff, man. I mean, there's some other stuff that's like primo, you know, it's really good. Get that and that's it. You know, you're gonna get your enlightenment, your changed perception is right there. So then you say, okay, I gotta get some better stuff. And then year after year, you spend years, you know, looking for the best stuff. Where's the best stuff? and meanwhile, you know, you keep thinking, I've almost got changed perception. I almost got it. I just can't quite abide in it, you know, because it wears off. It wears off. wears off. And then you've created a habit of slacking. Is the problem. The habit of slacking is what the world is after, to inculcate the habit of being a spiritual slacker is what the ego is after, 100%. Of course, drinking now, they're all hard alcohol advertisements are all over the programs that children watch, like baseball games, for instance, something a lot of kids watch, a very impressionable age. And this hard alcohol is all over that advertising. You know, the hard alcohol advertisers are trying to push it on kids as much as possible and saying, hey, this is how you become a responsible member of society, by being a spiritual slacker. And here's your ticket. Here's how you do it. We're going to help you do it. We're the good guys. We're the good guys. Now, cigarettes, they hate. You see, the ego doesn't like cigarettes, actually. Because cigarettes, don't necessarily make you a slacker. I mean, remember Franklin Merrill Wolf smoked cigarettes. Nisargadatta Guru smoked cigarettes. It doesn't automatically turn you into a slacker. Sometimes it gets you in some way, I don't know. But it's not as effective as like alcohol or pot or other drugs like that. Or caffeine is a problem, because the what I found is that You plateau. You can make a big push with caffeine, and then you just feel like you're suddenly stuck in this plateau, and you can't get out of it for days. You know, as I've noticed, it's terrible. It's just terrible. You just your mind just feels like flatlined in some way. You can't quite get the depth that you need, and then you drink more caffeine to push it more like that. So caffeine can burn you out on the spiritual path. You can get great insight that way at a certain level, but it doesn't go beyond that level is the problem with caffeine. So again, it's a dead end. All these crutches are dead ends, actually. They're dead ends, and the ego knows it, so the ego promotes it. But for some reason, the ego absolutely hates cigarettes now, at least in the West. Anyone who smokes cigarettes is the devil. But smoke pot, it's fine. It's good. It's good for it. It's medicinal. It cures everything. It cures everything. Turns you into a great person. But smoke a cigarette, it's going to put you on the gallows pretty soon. You know, you're killing the children. There it again. Hey, just a breath of that and you're killing all the children. That is for sure. You know, that's what they say. But pot smoke, nobody said a word about secondhand pot smoke. They say it's good for the kids. Those kids, you know, the hippies raising their kids around all pot smoke all the time. They say, well, I have no problem with that. That's great for the kids. It, you know, helps wake them up to higher perspective. And oh yeah, right. Perception, new perceptions, etc. You know, the vision of oneness is totally transcendent of these foolish egoic concepts of what it is. And the ego always says, well, just give me a concept and I'll figure out how to, well, what's good for that. There is no concept for what is free of concepts. The value is that it's free of concepts. That is the value. All right? That's part of, that's an aspect of its value. And you could say that's its value. It is free. It is free of the packaging. It is free of concepts. It is totally, absolutely without concepts. So how do you, the ego says, just give me a concept and I'll tell you how to reach that concept. Well, there is no concept. The vision of oneness is this inclusiveness. It is this effortlessness. This effortlessness. It is centerlessness. It is the shared identity of the shared identity of shared identity. It is the oneness of oneness. It is the oneness of oneness. That's what it is. But the ego will say, well, those aren't concepts. That's right. So if you want to talk about it, you really need to use this double phrasing like this, like a paradigm. It is the oneness of oneness. And so, well, at least there's some words there, you know, so we feel like we're in familiar territory. It's the oneness of oneness. It is the blessedness of blessedness. So the ego cannot give us a way to get there. The ego says, well, you didn't give me a clear concept, so how can I get there? How can I help you? Don't need to help us, ego. Thank you, but no thanks. Thanks, but no thanks. The ego says, well, if I don't help you, how can you get there? Holy Spirit. The ego goes, I don't know anything about the Holy Spirit. You're just making that up. No, we're not. We'll see. The smoothed outness. The smoothed outness. The still stillness. It is the still stillness. It is the ever-present ever-presentness. It is the effortless presence of effortless presence. Now, you need to be self-referential in how you talk about it. It is the effortless presence of the effortless presence. The vision of oneness is the effortless presence of the effortless presence. Ego, that puts the ego to sleep, actually, which is a good thing. We want the ego to go to sleep. So there is a way to use language that puts the ego to sleep, because the ego doesn't value, sees no value in it. So just when it sees absolutely no value, it tends to just like be de-energized and conk out on us. It seems to go to sleep. Because you're emphasizing no value to it whatsoever. And so it's just like, its interest drops to zero, you know, to zero out the ego's interest. Of course, if we want the ego to be interested, then that makes us nervous. We say, hey, ego, wake up. We need your advice on this. What do you think about this? The totalness. The totality of totality, the everywhereness of everywhereness. I'm experiencing the everywhereness of everywhereness. And of course, the ego will say, what kind of drug are you on? I'm not familiar with that drug. Tell me what kind of drug and I'll make sure everybody gets it. I'll legalize it, make sure everybody's on that drug, whatever it is, just tell me what you got. Or, hey, man, you must have found the right pot somewhere. Where'd you get it? What kind of pot is that? The ego will ask you that. What kind of drug are you on anyway? I want to know, because I can. Then I'll give it to everybody and it will all be enlightened. That is what the ego's interested in. Just tell us what the... Maybe you found a new drug. Tell us what the new drug is. Well, the totality of totality. The totality of totality. Shared identity of shared identity, the unity of unity, the unity of unity, the love of love, the love of love, the sacredness of sacredness, the sacredness of sacredness, the blessing of blessing. the bishop was saying, bless you, bless you, bless you, yesterday. And the bishop could say, the blessings of blessings upon you. The blessings of blessing upon you. The blessing of blessing upon you. That would be the right blessing. The blessing of blessing. The eternal life of eternal life. This shuts the ego up. The Holy Spirit recommended this to me just about an hour and a half ago, 2 hours ago. Said, do this kind of talk. Double up on your words here. Double up on them and see what happens. So I'm trying it, and it puts the ego to sleep. The oneness of oneness. The realness of realness, the reality of reality, the truth of truth, the truth of truth, the truth of truth be upon you, the truth of truth be upon you, see, may the truth of truth be upon you. This is the right way to speak to one another. May the blessing of blessing be upon you. May the divinity of divinity be upon you. And it knocks the ego out. The ego doesn't talk that way. It doesn't think that way. It cannot think that way. The ego cannot think that way. May the light of light be upon you. May the light of light be upon you. The ego will use single terms. Oh, may the light and love and peace and be upon you. No, that's the ego. You may say, may the peace of peace be upon you. May the peace of peace and the light of light and the love of love be upon you. The ego is like backing away, like kryptonite. What? What are you? What? Ah! It's like withdrawing, like you're radioactive. Really, the ego thinks you've just gone radioactive somehow. And the ego says, "No, what do you mean? Well, I can't figure that out. What are you talking about?" May the timelessness of timelessness be upon you. May the now of now be upon you. See? May the life of life be with you. The serenity of serenity be with you. May the bliss of bliss be with you. Now, when I talk about earlier, I talk about the training generations of training until they finally come up with a generation that is will easily be able to be freaked out by something. Well, this is what I'm talking about, is the language of the vision of oneness of the Holy Spirit is going towards this doubling up on may the bliss of bliss be with you. Now, they've trained kids to freak out if they hear this sort of stuff, like, You know, I'm listening to a lunatic. And they're threatening. I feel threatened. I feel threatened is what they're going to say. I feel threatened. And the ego will say, look, all you got to do is just say, may bliss be upon you. That's all. It's simple. See, the ego will say, very reasonable request, the ego says. Totally reasonable request. Nobody could be against this. I'm only asking you, just don't double down on the phrase. Just say, may bliss be upon you. May peace be upon you. That's, how could anybody be upset about that, you see? And it seems so reasonable, and the little girls and boys will say, oh yeah, that's okay with me if they did that. It's okay. And the parents say, sure, that would be all right. And the grandparents say, yeah, okay. Everybody agrees. So it's a done deal, right? The ego says, done deal. And you say, no, I've got to say the bliss of bliss. And the ego says, well, you're being unreasonable. I don't know how many times I've heard that I'm being unreasonable when I'm just insisting upon the right language, the right spiritual context to be used, the effectiveness to be utilized, effectiveness. The ego doesn't want effectiveness. It wants ineffectiveness, but it wants it packaged in a patina of spirituality. So it says, may bliss be upon you. Bless you. May bliss be upon you. Fine. But when you say, may the bliss of bliss be upon you, the ego is like completely freaking out about that. And it should say, hey, ego, if bliss is so great, you should want a double scoop. So maybe you got the problem, ego. Maybe you're abnormal. Why wouldn't you want a double scoop of perfection? The perfection of perfection. There is no inside, there is no outside. It is pointing to this. It undermines the whole notion of thingness, doesn't it? In terms of thingness having an inside and an outside in terms of pure spaciousness, or zero dimensionality, or everywhereness. Does everywhereness have an inside and an outside? And if it doesn't, how can things have an inside and an outside in the context of everywhereness? Do they somehow crystallize everywhereness into a form? If no. So the everywhereness of everywhereness, the bliss of bliss, is freeing us from this horrible delusion that everywhereness is not everywhere. That it surrounds things, but is not within them. In the same way it's within the space around the things. And what we have to get to, the vision of oneness shows us that everywhereness not only surrounds everything, it is also totally within everything, the exact same way that it surrounds everything. And since it joins the inside and the outside seamlessly, there is no inside and there is no outside. There is no inside and there is no outside. This is what the vision of oneness shows us and frees us from this terrible duality of inside and outside of pure spaciousness, which is really our attempt to uncreate creation, actually. And so this language of doubling down is very important. The peace of peace, the peace of peace, it gives us this reinforcement for the vision of oneness. That's why the ego hates it. That's why we've not been trained to speak this way. Have you ever heard anybody speak this way is the question. The peace of peace upon you. Very rarely. I don't know if I ever have. Maybe a few times in a few phrases or something is possible, yeah. But the Holy Spirit just suggested it to me this evening, saying, hey, try this. It's time to try this. And find out. And of course, most people think it's completely nuts. But for me, I said, no. I think I see where this is going. It's to get us past this horrible blockage of inside and outsideness, of pure spaciousness. We're so addicted to things and the space that surrounds things. Believing that is reality. But pure spaciousness, which is the reality, pure everywhereness. How can pure everywhereness be surrounding things and in things, but not everywhere? How is that possible? It's not, is it? So it must be, is there some border where the everywhereness inside a thing meets the everywhereness outside the thing, and there's some border there that is an abyss or is not everywhere, or is it a perfect continuum actually? It's a perfect continuum. It's a plenum. It's a perfect plenum. And so there is no inside and there is no outside. And so really this whole things and spaciousness around things is a mirage. It's a delusion. It's a hallucination. It's a misperception. We're just telling ourselves that that's there to see. It's not there to experience. So when we're looking at this, we're really looking at nothing. It's not there. There isn't any break in the continuum of pure spaciousness, of pure everywhereness. So the language of remembrance is this doubling down. It's a doubling down. And it's taken me a long time to get to this point, to willing to do that. Because most people will say, you're nuts. But I know there are some who will recognize this instantly and say, that is it. That is no question, that's it. There are those who will, absolutely. The it of it. This is the isness of isness. This is the isness of isness. The isness of isness. The itness of itness. The freedom of freedom. The abidance of abidance. This is the abidance of abidance. This is the self of self. Man, again, we have the children wandering in and say, what are they talking about? I feel threatened. Shut them down. That's the ego's plan. Okay, ego's plan. Because who can turn away from the tears of a child? You know, the ego says, you can stop all the tears of the children in the whole world if you just drop that second, you know, the bliss of bliss. Just drop, just do it, just one, not two. Come on, don't do that. All the tears of the children in the world will stop, and you'll be a hero to the world. And if you insist upon saying the freedom of freedom, all the children in the world will cry and tears of fear. They'll be frightened and so disturbed, hysterically disturbed. They'll be crying tears, and you'll be causing them to cry all those tears. So just drop just that one. It's, you know, easy, right? Easy for you. That is what the ego's marketing campaign is based on, actually. It's based on that. The children. Okay? It is based on the children. Always, it's got to, the ego's been aiming for that point. Do it for the children, the ego will say. Drop that second qualifier. The peace of peace be upon you. May the peace of peace be upon you. The ego says, just drop it and say, may peace be upon you. Please, just do that. Yeah, just do that. And then you see, you maintain the subject-object dualistic outside-inside space surrounding objects construct matrix. In other words, the ego says, just remain in the matrix and all the children will be happy. Don't talk about something other than the matrix. You know, this is all the children know. You don't want to scare the children. Come on. Don't be a bad person and scare the children. And so, this is the ego's marketing campaign. This is World War III, actually. This is World War III. It is World War III. It's the ego saying, hey, time to drop it and pledge loyalty. You'll never use it. You'll never scare the children again by using the double peace, may peace, the peace of peace be upon you. Say, mommy, I don't understand the language they're using. They're confusing me. I've never heard anyone speak this way. Well, you didn't teach me how to think this way. I'm causing me to feel losing my identity is horrible. I'm very scared to teach them to make sure they talk properly to me. So you can't go to a child and say, may the peace of peace be upon you. Child say, what? Who is this person? What are they saying? They're frightening me. You can't go to many adults and say that because they were indoctrinated as children too. Can't go to hardly anybody and say that these days. No one's ever, rarely, if anyone spoke to me that way, few. Thank you very much for that. Absolutely, very helpful. May the oneness of oneness dawn upon you. May the dawn of dawn be upon you. May the dawn of dawn be upon you. You see, when you start speaking like this, I can feel it. It's like instant, you know, satori. You know, it just brings you right there. And you're not scared anymore. When I say right there, it means your fear evaporates because the ego drops out. It's not with you anymore. It can't hang with you anymore. It thinks you've gone completely bonkers, and it's splitting from you. It's leaving. It's taking all its friends with it, too. His whole family, all its relatives, everybody, the whole extended family, ego's moving out. That's where can't hang around when you've gone completely nuts. Untreatable. You're untreatable now. The inclusivity of inclusivity. May the inclusivity of inclusivity and the dawn of dawn and the oneness of oneness bring the bliss of bliss upon you. See? Upon and upon and upon you. And you and you and you and you and you. And the cat has just shown up. It must be getting later in the, well, it's not that late, but the cat is saying, I guess the cat says, I need to come early because that's going to take a long time to get you to finally stop taping and feed me. So it's going to probably start early and maybe take 20 minutes or half an hour or whatever. That's how it usually goes. And patient. Cat is patient. May the dawn of dawn be upon you. May the dawn of dawn dawn upon you. May the dawning of the dawn, dawn, may the dawning of the dawning dawn upon you. May the peace of the peace, may the peace of peace be peace upon you. Be the peace upon you. May the peace of peace be the peace upon you. May the peace of peace, may the bliss of bliss be the bliss upon you. May the bliss of bliss be the bliss upon you. Yeah, the ego's really freaking out now. They're training these kids to be all ego, total egotists. So they will freak out. When you speak this way, the ego freaks out. There's no question about it. And so they want the young people or want to be these total egotists. So if they hear this, they'll just like freak out and say, ah, someone's trying to annihilate me. Yeah, like that. Whereas other generations, like my generation, when someone say, may the peace of peace be the peace upon you. We'd say, some of us would say, maybe we wouldn't say anything. Probably just be quiet. I'd probably just be quiet. Someone spoke that way. I'd be just thinking and say, who is this? Is there some kind of guru? Is this a guru? Or what is this? Spiritual teaching? Or, you know, is this valuable? I'd be thinking, you know, this feels like valuable. It is like that. If you hear something like that, I just be quiet. See, it sounds like something very valuable. I think I'll just shut up and see what else they have to say. I wouldn't leave. No way. I'd say, wow, say that again. Let me hear that again. May the bliss of bliss be the bliss upon you. may the dawn of dawn dawn upon you. May the oneness of oneness be the oneness. May the oneness of oneness be the oneness. Upon you. Within and without you. Either inside or outside of you. May the bliss of bliss be the bliss that is neither inside nor outside of you. See, now if someone spoke like that, I would stop. May the bliss of bliss be the bliss that is neither inside nor outside of you. May the peace of peace be the peace that is neither inside nor outside of you. That is neither inside nor outside. May the peace of peace, that is the peace that is neither inside nor outside, be upon you. Be neither inside nor outside of you. May the peace of peace, that is the peace that is neither inside nor outside, be neither inside nor outside upon you. So you can go like that. Yeah, you can say, may the peace of peace be upon you. Same thing. No question. I was reading A Course in Miracles, I think yesterday, and I came across what Jesus was saying. There's no question that he's pointing exactly at the vision of oneness, vision of Christ, the name of God, the one name of God, the one shared identity, exactly at it. I said, this is it. This is what you have to get to. Just crystal clear. Unambiguous. And pointing out the trepidation that we have, etc. There's a moth flying around here, and the cat is trying to catch it. You see, the moth is what is... Maybe the bliss of bliss that is neither inside nor outside. And the cat is, I can't get it. It's looking for it now. The moth is very non-linear. The butterfly is very non-linear, isn't it? I remember a dream I had recently where I went to this natural history museum and it had all these huge panels on the wall of all these butterflies pinned to the wall. All these different colored butterflies pinned to the wall. People were going through this museum saying, oh wow, this is really cool. Didn't have any live butterflies, right? Pinned butterflies symbolize linear, discursive, egoic thought process, belief process, belief system. And living butterflies is the non-dual, neither inside nor outsideness. May the peace of peace be the peace that is neither inside of you nor outside of you. So, time is ticking away, isn't it? as we will be definitely hit by this pressure of everybody. Basically, the way it goes is there'll just be a general consensus. Like, everyone will just say, hey, at least we can agree on one thing. The eagle will say that. He says, look, the eagle said, look, we got all this discord in the world. We got all these problems in the world. We got these, you know, potential wars and hotspots and enmity. And the eagle just say, look at the world, it's so terrible. And the eagle say, I've got something for everybody. Can we not just agree on one thing? The eagle is going to push this campaign. And said, let's focus on our children and our children's future. And let's all the planet agree upon this, that let us ask the children what they want. Okay, instead of being so selfish, let's ask the children what they want. That's the ego's push. And of course, the world will feel they can unify around this, around the children. And of course, what the ego leaves out is the children have been super indoctrinated and brainwashed over three generations of effort to be freaked out at any use of this compounded bliss of bliss, neither inside nor outside, type of language or ideology or focus, etc. That the one thing they want to do is ask people not to drop all of that confusion for them. They don't want to be confused. They want the linear, egoic stuff exclusively. And the world will say, you know what? That's a simple, easy, childish request of a child. How can we deny the children that? It's easy, because there's only a few people, crazy people in the world anyway, are using that language, so we might as well just, you know, just it's easy to stop it. And for the good of all the children, the whole world can agree that's the right step to take. You see how that works? See how clever the ego is? Very clever, of course, because it's our own projection and we're using our own creativity to do this. That's how it happens, is the world decides, you know what, we got to do a better job for our children. Let's ask them what they want. Of course, we've programmed them to give us the answer that we want them to give us, which is let's get rid of this high spiritual effectiveness. Let's get rid of spiritual effectiveness. Let's get rid of effectiveness towards the vision of oneness. Let's just get rid of that. And this is a very simple thing. Just don't use the compound words like that. Just don't say the peace of peace, which is the peace with neither inside nor outside. The peace of peace be upon you. Just drop it. Drop the just one peace, one bliss, all the, not the compound of the bliss of bliss. And everyone will say that's a no-brainer. Done deal, right? Nobody can be against that. You see the pressure, the leverage that you brought to bear in the world, that almost everyone on the planet will say nobody could possibly be against that. And if they are, they're just simply an evil person, totally evil person. Who could be against that? Simple request. You're standing in the way of a peaceful future for the children of this world by denying that simple, easy request. What an atrocious person you are. That's the pressure that is now being brought to bear upon us. So who could withstand that in this world, honestly? Who could really withstand that? Could I withstand that? I mean, who could really withstand that, actually, if the whole planet is looking at you and saying, you're the lone holdout, you know, the whole planet, so to speak, and all you're holding out for is just the right to be able to use these compound words like this, like the bliss of bliss, neither inside nor outside, this kind of concept. And so you're just being completely arbitrary and unreasonable to hold on to that. And so, you know, everybody in the whole world wants you to drop it. And when you do, you know, you'll be, then the whole world, every peace will come upon the planet, you know, because we finally ask the children what they want. Funny, they never ask the children what they want when the children were not brainwashed. Because if they asked me, I would have told them what I want. I would have told them, hey, I want this double use of, the compound use of, like, bliss, bliss. No inside, no outside. I would have told them, that's the ticket. As a child, I would have told them, that's what I want. They never asked you then. They only ask you when you've been three or four generations of being brainwashed. Then they ask the children what they want. And the children, like little robots, say, yeah, that's what I want. I know, I've been told what they want. And so then now the ego says, finally, we're asking the children what they want. And we think we've had a major planetary breakthrough and a planetary ascension on the way because we finally respect the children enough to ask them what they really want. And now they're telling us and we finally get it. We finally get it. We need to use this linear language and make sure we can put this in one world religion, because the children have now spoken to us. We say the children have spoken to us, these very advanced spiritual children. They want this linear language that goes like this, and this is how they want it, and say, well, let's do it. Let's do it. And how can anybody resist that, you see, is the question. How can anyone resist that? That is the trouble. That is World War III. That is the ideological situation that we're at. And it's been very carefully crafted, actually. Very carefully crafted. Now, of course, the wise ones know all about it. Jesus, I'm sure, Holy Spirit has shown me what's happening. So it's known. And it may be necessary to sidestep that kind of pressure, because who can withstand that pressure? When I've been talking all these years about severe pressure, a problem is going to come in the world. This is what I'm talking about. The cat's out of the bag. Because this is it. This is the pressure. And when you think about it, you realize, oh my gosh, that's too much pressure. I didn't think it would come to that. Yes, it has come to that. Yes, it is. And the world could very well, suddenly, it seems as though peace is within our grasp finally. Because we found out how to make our children happy finally. Because we finally brainwashed them into giving the egoic answer that the ego wants. And we now have the leverage to get rid of anybody who refuses the little children's request, you see. So, that's it. That is it. And what little child is going to say, no, I think it's perfectly acceptable. In fact, I want the usage of the bliss of bliss be upon you with the bliss, be the peace of peace. Be the peace upon you that is neither inside nor outside of you. That is effortlessly neither inside nor outside of you. May that peace of peace be upon you now and now and now. And the child says, that's what I want to hear. You know, how many children are going to say, that's what I want to hear from my parents, from my teacher, from my social contacts? Who's going to say that? Maybe a few, and maybe only a few, I don't know. Maybe none. So it puts, you know, too much pressure on people who realize this is the effectiveness. So we will see what happens coming up. I've been told something is going to happen coming up, for sure. And I've been warned about this blitzkrieg that's coming on the planet. Where we will think we have we're going to come together in unity in the world and find peace by finally putting our children first and what they want first. And everybody will be patting themselves on the back and saying, you know, we finally did it. We finally, after all these years, took us 3 generations, but we finally did it. We broke the old authoritarian back of the past who didn't listen to children, you know, and we're finally being sensitive and responsible citizens and spiritual citizens. We're finally doing it. And what are they doing? They're totally falling into the ego's trap. 100%. 100%. C'est la vie, you know. That's how it is. That's how it goes. When we are caught up, you know, we have this severe continuity problem, we end up listening to the ego. Listening to the ego. And when we work on the continuity problem, we listen to the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit will point out to us, hey, there's this, you know, trap coming up. Better be ready. As Jesus said, you better have your lamp lit. You better have your wedding garment on. Jesus was very big about being prepared. You better have your lamp lit. You better not sold the oil to somebody, right? I mean, you better have it lit. Because, in other words, you better be clear about what's coming in this world. And it's something that most people have not even considered, you know, but ponder on it, be aware of it, and realize, you know what, I don't really want to be caught up in that sort of leveraged situation. It's super, 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 super leveraged situation, where the hydraulics of it, the spiritual hydraulics of it, just are going to put like ungodly pressure on everybody. To just everyone say, yeah, oh, sure, I can do that. I'm not going to say the oneness of oneness. No, I'm not going to practice that way. I'm going to say the oneness. That's fine. And I can explain it. Well, it's the oneness that is, you know, that's divine and it's peaceful and it, this. But I don't need to say it is the oneness of oneness. That is the oneness that is neither inside nor outside of oneness. It is the peace of peace that is neither inside nor outside the peace of peace. Easy. St. Peter said, I don't know Jesus. Three times. I don't know him. Jesus was pointing that out, that the fear of compounding, like the peace of peace that is neither inside nor outside the peace of peace. You know, that's like four, something is compounding. And Jesus, St. Peter said, I don't know him. See, saying, oh, that's too much pressure on me now. Too much pressure. Jesus said that's what's going to happen to you, too much pressure on you. And we're told now that there's going to be too much pressure on us. So we'll see what the response of the Holy Spirit is to this situation. At least the cat's out of the bag. I've been able to express it here and share it with the world. So the world is no longer, you know, there's no light on it in the world. There's a light so that these people can say, ah, it's not completely dark on this situation. And just realize what the ego's trying to do. It's trying to remove the effectiveness so you know you just can't quite make it. You can't make it because this, doubling down on this, which the peace of peace, the peace of peace, may the peace of peace be upon you. May the peace of peace that is neither inside nor outside be upon you. But if it's neither inside or outside and it's upon you, what are you, right? What are you? And if it's the peace of peace, what is the peace of peace? The peace of peace, which is neither inside nor outside of you, be upon you. See, that's the fight that puts the ego to sleep. That's the final exercise, in my opinion. It's the way to finish and enter the vision of oneness. It puts the ego to sleep. The ego does not want to be put to sleep. So it says, look, the first thing about a peaceful world, the ego says, is the ego's got to be here to advise you. So the first step is to outlaw this usage of language like this. I mean, they're trying to ban use of language. They've been working at this for quite some time. So the ego says, you got to ban this first. That's the first step. Otherwise, I won't even be around to advise you how to be happy, how to build this peaceful world. I won't even be your advisor. Oh, terrible, terrible problem, ego. So it's got to ban this. And it's been almost tacitly banned because nobody uses it. But the ego wants to make sure that no one will ever use it. So we're headed right there, right now, no problem. All right, anything else? So may the peace of peace and the bliss of bliss and the oneness of oneness be the experience that is neither inside you nor outside of you. The experience that is neither inside of you nor outside of you be upon you. May the experience that is neither inside of you nor outside of you be upon you. The experience of experience. May the experience of experience that is neither inside nor outside of you be upon you. All right, that's it.